everybody, what's going on? I am Gregg Sussman, joined once again by Jim Sonnis of FanDuel, who's here to go over some of the undervalued players heading into week number 8. What's happening, Jim?
Yeah, this is a pretty good slate for value, Gregg. A lot of really interesting guys available to us and some ones we'll need to discuss to figure out if we can actually trust them or not. But I'm feeling pretty good about these guys entering week 8. How are you doing?
I'm doing awesome, man. All 6 players we're talking about today are playing at home this week, which you have to like. So let's begin at the quarterback position, which is exactly where we began last week, with the same player, just a different matchup. It's Gardner Minshew and the Jags taking on the Jets. Minshew is priced under $7,000 this week. We saw the Jets get thrashed on Monday night, and it sounds like you think Gardner Minshew could do some more thrashing on Sunday.
Yeah, he definitely could, because Minshew's had some tough matchups pretty much all year long, and the Jets aren't really as bad as their perception, but they're not a plus defense, that is for sure, especially with C.J. Mosley seeming like he's probably going to miss this game once again for the Jets. And when you look at the total in this game, it's very low, and that could push people away, and I think it should usually, but I think it is a good candidate to go over in this game because the Jets with Sam Darnold at quarterback ranked 17th in seconds per snap, whereas without him, they were ranked 32nd and dead last by a pretty wide margin. So they're a faster-paced team when Darnold is out there, which bodes well for the Jets, but also bodes well for Gardner Minshew. Minshew, as mentioned, had some tough matchups, still been pretty good. The Jets ranked 17th against the pass based on number fire schedule-adjusted metrics, which means he should move the ball so far this year. It's the second best matchup he has had as a starter so far. He is $6,900, and I think that you could get some exposure to this game, whether it be Gardner Minshew, Leonard Fournette, Le'Veon Bell, Robbie Anderson. It's not as bad as it appears. And if we do get a little bit of back and forth here, the Jets score some points, that's going to bode well for Gardner Minshew. The Jaguars have to keep their foot on the gas pedal. So I think that Minshew is not a standout play from the value perspective by any means, and I'd much rather pay up for guys like Deshaun Watson and Jared Goff, but when you want to spend down, there's not a whole lot cooking below $7,000, so I'm going to take the safe route and go with a guy we know has a good floor and has a little bit of a ceiling too. That's Gardner Minshew.
Minshew's certainly safe enough with a ceiling that may not be super high, but is certainly good enough at $6,900. Priced under $7,000, going with Gardner Minshew at the quarterback position opens up a lot of space along the rest of your lineup. But if you want to pay up for the quarterback, you need to find value elsewhere. And that, of course, brings us to Ty Johnson, one that you obviously knew was coming. Ty Johnson's priced at just over $5,000 this week and is expected to start in place of Kerryon Johnson on Sunday against the Giants. The Giants allowed a ton of yards and touchdowns to the Cardinals' backup running back, Chase Edmonds, last week. Let's see what they will do and will allow Ty Johnson to do on Sunday.
Yeah, I think it's pretty fair to have at least some concerns around Ty Johnson entering this week. But when you look back at their usage last week of Ty Johnson in that game, it was pretty encouraging. He played more than 60% of the snaps. He had finished that game with 10 carries and 4 targets. And 2 of those carries actually came before Kerryon Johnson got hurt. I was initially a bit scared about Ty Johnson because he had lost a role to J.D. McKissic the week before that. His snap rate had cratered. But then last week, early in that first quarter, they did get Ty Johnson involved, and he had 2 carries before Kerryon went out. After that, it was 8 carries for Ty Johnson with 4 targets, whereas J.D. McKissic had 4 carries and 2 targets, and most of that work for McKissic came on third down, whereas Ty Johnson got all of his work on first and second down. So if you're looking at the way the Lions may use Ty Johnson, I would expect that he does leave the field for some third downs in favor of J.D. McKissic, but we're probably going to get about 67% of the snaps. He's probably going to get most of the early down rushes. He'll probably get, 4 to 5 targets. And for $5,200 at home against this Giants defense tied to Matthew Stafford with how he's playing this year, I think that's good enough to dive in. So Ty Johnson, probably not going to be a bell cow in this offense. I would not expect him to be, but he has talent. The guy is super fast, got a good matchup, and his workload should be good enough for him to pay off. So while the concerns around Ty Johnson are justified, I think that the salary is low enough and the spot is good enough, we can still go at him here at $5,200.
The concerns, they are definitely real when it comes to Ty Johnson. How Matt Patricia deploys this committee, also a legit concern. But Ty Johnson has speed. He's a Maryland guy. And he's worth starting this week against the New York Giants because their defense, not so good. $5,200, it is hard to avoid Ty Johnson across the board on FanDuel. Another undervalued player this week is James White. He's facing off against the Browns. He's priced at $6,000. And James White hasn't had that dominant game yet. But the wide receiving core for New England, it's not all that good. Sure, they acquired Mohamed Sanu, and they have sent Josh Gordon to IR, but there's just not much here. I think we're waiting for that James White explosive game. Is it coming this week?
Yeah, it very well could. Part of the reason that James White hasn't done a whole lot this year is because the Patriots haven't played any tight games. They have won 6 of their 7 games by 16 or more points, and they could do that again this weekend. They are 13-point favorites against the Browns, but this Browns offense coming off a bye, they've got some good players in that offense. They could score points and make the Patriots keep passing later in the game, and if they do that, that would bode well for James White. He has played 4 games since he missed that game due to the birth of his child. And in those 4 games, despite the Patriots winning 3 of those by pretty much a landslide, he has gotten 10, 9, 9, and 8 targets. That is a really good number. And the thing you have to like about that is that a lot of those targets are in close towards the goal line. He has 10 targets inside the 20-yard line this year, and he has 4 targets inside the 10, but despite that, he has just 1 touchdown all year long. Basically, the reason he has not had a big game so far is because the touchdowns have not been there. And I want running backs who can pay off without touchdowns, but James White has been good enough without those touchdowns where if he does score, he's going to have a really good day. So I think that we should see, hopefully, a bit of a closer game here for New England. If that does wind up happening, it would increase the dropbacks for Tom Brady. That would increase the targets for James White. So, yeah, it's been a weird year for him so far, but he's not totally off the map. And I think that we could see a better output from James White. And those touchdowns for him will come eventually.
Hopefully that positive touchdown regression begins this Sunday at home against the Cleveland Browns. We've seen Sony Michel find his way to fall into the end zone. James White, hopefully, you're up next. Moving on to the wide receivers, we go to Houston. This is an obvious one, and we talked about him yesterday. It's Kenny Stills. There's no Will Fuller in the lineup here, which means Kenny Stills is going to be the deep threat all game long for Deshaun Watson and the Houston Texans. They're home against the Raiders, and Stills is priced under $6,000. We mentioned it yesterday, Jim, but clearly a lot to like.
Yeah, Kenny Stills is kind of like the ideal for guys in this salary range. What I want for a wide receiver who is lower than $6,000 is I want them to be big play guys. I want them to get targets down the field because it doesn't take as much volume to pay off there, and I kind of want them to be able to hit on not a ton of volume because you're not going to get a lot of guys who get 10 targets, unless it's Tyler Boyd, below $6,000. So you want guys who have the ability to pay off on not a ton of volume, and Kenny Stills is the poster boy for that in this matchup here with Oakland. We saw what Aaron Rodgers did to this Oakland defense last week while playing with a bunch of banged-up guys. Kenny Stills is a really good player and stepping into a large role of $5,700. He played 95% of the snaps for Houston last week. He had 5 total targets, and 2 of those targets were deep. So Kenny Stills is never going to have this great floor because he does get so much work down the field. It's kind of like we discussed with Marquise Brown earlier in the year, where he's going to have days where he doesn't catch a lot of balls, and that would be disappointing. But the upside here is really, really good, and I want exposure to that upside in this matchup, in this stadium, when he's playing at home and on turf. So Kenny Stills is going to have bad days, even when Will Fuller is out, but I think the odds he hits a good day here are pretty high. So I like Kenny Stills a ton. I think that he is my favorite wide receiver, potentially on the entire slate, even while acknowledging that the risks are certainly there. I think that his upside is just too good to pass up at $5,700.
I agree. The ceiling is way too high at $5,700 to just avoid Kenny Stills this week. Yes, there's that chance of a 3-for-38 outing, a 4-for-45, but you know Deshaun Watson wants to take a deep shot, and you also know that he trusts Kenny Stills. Bill O'Brien came out this week and said, yeah, this trade for Laramie Tunsil and Kenny Stills, it's worked out all right for us, naming both of these guys. Kenny Stills has been a big winner thus far for the Houston Texans and for fantasy owners, and we think that only takes the next step here this week. Another wide receiver that Jim likes and he believes is undervalued is Calvin Ridley. Now, there's been a lot of questions if Matt Ryan will be able to give it a go on Sunday against Seattle. And the rumor is he very might will. Does that make sense? Not sure. But I can tell you he's $5,400, and that makes sense to put him in your lineup.
Yeah, if Matt Ryan can't go, we're out. We're not touching the Falcons if that happens. But if Matt Ryan does go, Calvin Ridley got an improved role this week with Mohamed Sanu being traded, and that's not accounted for in his salary. We've talked about Calvin Ridley a lot of times on this show, and every time I've used the word volatile. And yeah, he's still going to be volatile because he gets a lot of work down the field, just like Kenny Stills, But that volatility will go down with Mohamed Sanu being elsewhere, because the snap rate for Calvin Ridley should go up, and he should see a higher target load in this offense. His upside will still be the same, so his ceiling is still going to be very good, as it has been the entire year, but his floor will get better, and that's really encouraging for a guy who is $5,400. This Seattle secondary is nothing we need to fear all that much. They're at home. They're in a spot where the Falcons are probably going to have to keep on chucking it, so it sets up really well for Calvin Ridley. If Matt Ryan cannot go, then I'm probably not going to go here. Philip Dorsett is $5,600. I don't mind him. Mike Williams is $5,700. He is also in line for some positive regression, so I would go to those guys. But if Matt Ryan can't go, Calvin Ridley is really fun. That game would be pretty fun. But Ridley for $5,400 would be a really good wide receiver if he has his quarterback available.
As long as Matt Ryan plays, Calvin Ridley is in a fine position to be successful against the Seattle defense that has been stingy, but the Falcons can certainly score the football without Mohamed Sanu. Ridley's going to get all the snaps he can handle on the outside. It's going to be Julio Jones being option 1A, and Calvin Ridley is 1B, and we'll take that at $5,400. One last position to get to, and that's tight end, and you're not going with a tight end that most people were talking about for Indianapolis last week, and Eric Ebron. You're going with Jackie D, Jack Doyle, and we're all looking for tight ends to stream. Why are you going with Jack Doyle this week at under $5,000?
Well, it's because Jack Doyle actually runs routes and gets snaps, so that's usually a valuable thing at tight end. Eric Ebron's fine. You know, I like the upside there, but I like the floor with Jack Doyle, and part of the thinking here is that the Colts do like to throw more at home than they do on the road. In the three home games they have played, Jacoby Brissett's pass attempts have been 37, 46, and 39. They are much more of a pass-heavy team when they are on turf than when they are on grass, and they are on turf for this weekend, and that would generally bode well for T.Y. Hilton. But he's going to see Chris Harris. And Chris Harris is a genuinely talented player, which means that T.Y. Hilton's target load may go down a bit, which means those targets got to go elsewhere. And in the one game that T.Y. Hilton missed, it was Jack Doyle who got a lot of volume. He had 8 targets in that game, had a couple of red zone looks, and I think that could be good for him. Not thinking 8 targets for Jack Doyle, but if he can get 5 to 6 in this offense, and I would expect the Colts to score some points here against Denver, I think that bodes really well. So the upside for Jack Doyle, probably not that great. He's not going to get as many yards as Eric Ebron could get, but I think that if you're looking for a tight end below $5,000, you can't be that picky. So I think that Jack Doyle makes a lot of sense. Benjamin Watson is also $4,900. He played 75% of the snaps on Monday night, and he played a lot in the slot and out wide too. So I don't mind Benjamin Watson at the exact same salary as Jack Doyle, but Doyle is indoors in a spot where I expect Andy to score points, and his target load could be higher this week with T.Y. Hilton seeing tough coverage. So Jack Doyle, at least for me, back on the map in DFS this week.
He runs routes and plays in a dome. What else do you want for a tight end this week? That's Jack Doyle. Hey, Ben Watson is cheap. He did run routes as well and played a lot on Monday night. And as he gets more integrated in this Patriots system, maybe Ben Watson will become an option for you down the line. But this week, if you're choosing between one of those guys, Jack Doyle, the clear choice at $4,900. That's going to do it for us here on the FanDuel Hurry Up. Jim, it's been a blast. I appreciate your time. Good luck this week. We'll talk to you next week.
Thank you, Gregg. You as well. Enjoy the World Series. Good luck in Week 8, and we'll talk to you next week.
Thanks so much, Jim. Tomorrow, Gabe Morenci will join me as he gives us his 6 best bets for Week 8. I'm looking forward to it. We hope you are, too. Have a great night. Enjoy Thursday Night Football, and we'll see you tomorrow.